So now I'm going to start making some headway into the bird itself. I think I'm going to start on the feathers down here, just as a way of warming up in a sense. I don't even know if these are real feathers. They don't look like them, so they're mythical feathers. But that's not important. So I've just outlined some little fun feathers, and now I'm going to give them a little bit of sculpting using the safety edge chisel. One way to create a sense of unity or continuity, flow, pattern with carving like this is to do all of the cuts that are on the same plane, so to speak, in one go. So this top edge of the feathers I'm doing in one sweep. So no matter how much carving goes on, that fundamental understructure will remain. This creates something of a pattern, and I'll do the same here. I'm using a little safety edge chisel. I'm going to start forming the beak, starting way back here with a little bit of an edge. I'm doing this just to create the impression that this side of the beak actually has some form to it inside the mouth. I'm putting a little edge on. You just left it flat, it would appear to be a cardboard cutout beak. I'm going to come on this side. Now I'm being very careful so that this corner of the chisel doesn't catch the ground, but I'm going very close. As you can see, there's just the slightest of edge left. Alright, so now I'm going to try and feather this down a little bit more, chamfer it off. Now, what I'm doing here is in some respects the opposite of what I was doing when I was carving the ground. Of course, you're carving the ground, I'm using a slightly curved surface on the face, on the chisel, taking little scalloped cuts out and then trying to level it out. So the ground really curves in. This beak goes the other way. So now I'm using a flat piece. You saw me take the edge off and then I cut again another little plane and again. So I'm using the flat to keep taking off the little ridges and in that way slowly curve this piece over. Again, just as with the ground, you don't want the corners of the chisel to dig in. You have to be very careful here. As I take off that high point here, these corners of the chisel don't catch. So it's essentially the same thing again, but a mirror version. In that the ground, we're going concave, and now we're going convex. But it's the same skill, just a different tool and a different shape. I think at this point I want to lose some of the material here. No, it'd be almost impossible. Well, it wouldn't be impossible, but it'd be very, very difficult to continue this curve across here because it's so shallow. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this out here with a slightly rounded form and take this further down. I'm going to imagine there's a groove going up here just to create up the center of the beak there. So I'm going to take a bit of material out there so we don't have a great big flat boring shape. And I might do the same here. A bit of shaping on the side of the beak so we don't have just a flat thing. There's a mythical creature, but if you examine birds' beaks, especially the larger ones, there often is structure. It's not just a cone or a smooth surface. The shoe bill bird? The shoe bill is a lovely character. Right, so let's get a smaller gouge and take out some material here. That might do the trick a little bit more just to. So I've gone a little deeper on this side, and now I'm going to feather it out so it helps create the perspective I want. And now we're going to come under the eye here. This helps define the nostril as being a structural feature in the beak here also. Come around. Something interesting here. And I think the other important thing to remember is that it's very shallow relief carving. And you're not trying to do a literal three-dimensional carving. What you're trying to do is capture the light and shadow that suggests the true form. Always important to remember that. A very quick reference, of course, is most coins in your pocket, especially older coins that have reasonable portraiture. If you have a look how the heads are carved, you very quickly realize in that very, very shallow relief, there's quite a clever illusion of depth and three-dimensionality created. But it's in no way an attempt to make a flattened 3D model. It's a different thing. And that's important not to get caught by that trap of trying to make it a flattened three-dimensional object. You're playing with shadow. It's a drawing more than a sculpture in some respects. Very shallow relief carving is probably one of the most challenging forms of sculpture. You really are very limited in the material you can work with, but yet you have to create the illusion of lots of volume and form. And you can see why very careful control and being able to take just tiny slivers away is really important at this stage. This is where you're getting into sculpting, really playing with the shadows. And it's not going to work if I'm taking great big gouges out. I've really got to be able to take tiny, minuscule little slivers of material away. I think at this point I need to work a little bit around this beak here. Don't throw your chisels around like that. Want the beak to go, the lower jaw or lower part of the beak to be a little lower. Just a subtle effect. That little triangle in the middle there must come away in a moment. It can come out a bit more here. Now what I want to do is clean out the gap in here.
Turn it again without your finger in the way.
So I want to clean out the gap in here now to show that the beak has two parts and there's a a hollow in there. That's too small. I'm using a variety of very small chisels to clean out this recess here. Again, relying on just watching the cuts to try and end up with a nice smooth ground. And coming out here, I might be able to tidy out this if I'm careful. I don't want to come gouging out, so I'm going to turn it round and come back in on the beak here. So I can come off the ground that's already cut, and in a way that's my guide, isn't it? Coming into the beak. I don't want a horrible, messy part here, do I? Now I have to figure out some way to make this beak look as though it continues around the other side. I think that line needs to go through there. So what I'm going to do is actually cut below the ground and create the illusion that the beak continues further back. Now I need a tiny little beak chisel for this. I'm going to cut across. There we go. And stop there. That's about the size of it. Now I need to blend that tip in. In doing that, I think I'm going to use a slightly gouged chisel. That might do the trick. I am really making it up as I go along here. And this is how it is. It's about thinking carefully about the tool you're going to use and hopefully not creating more of a problem. Like if I use a V chisel now, it's going to be too wide. I think this little gouge will work. So I'm going to come in at an angle, create a bit of a shadow in here, hopefully, and then come around and maybe create the illusion that this lower part of the beak has got a hook to it and a bit of shadow. I think that might start to work. I've now got to come back and clear out the back of the beak. Now, when this is finished, or were I to finish it, this area I would probably put a fine texture on, very, very fine texture, with the intention not for the texture to be visible, but for the texture to hold a dark patina. So it would be in shadow in here. Okay, so there's that. What I could do at this point is use a little bit of Japanese ink. I've got bottled ink here, just for convenience. I want to put some ink around everywhere else, but because my fingers have been all over it, it's almost certainly going to be greasy. So I'm just going to give it a quick wash, just with a bit of ink. And then I'm going to rub it all off. And then a little Ponce bag. This is just a ball of cotton wool and a little tamping with talcum powder. And rub it all off. And this will hopefully degrease it so that the ink will paint on more readily. Get it in the nostril. And most importantly, in the mouth. Get on the feathers if you like. This is useful. It's useful to do this at the end of the day and leave it and then come back in the morning, the next day. And you can look afresh while you're having your morning tea, if you're like me, a creature of a habit like that. You can sit and look at the piece. Now, if I go at this with tissue now, I'll wipe the ink away. So sometimes it's helpful just to leave it for a few minutes, just to dry out a little bit. All right, so I've let the ink dry for a few moments, and then just very lightly, I can rub it off. And we start to get more of a painterly effect. And this is really important, I think. You can start to see how the sculpture's coming along. Just as I say, let the ink dry a little bit. Then you can give it a gentle wipe. And you can see where the piece is starting to come alive. I'm actually really quite happy with this. And the little beak. As I say, I'm not trying to do an ornithological study. This is a mythical creature. And I'm trying to illustrate carving technique and process, not how to carve a bird. No such bird exists, really. Although I feel maybe one should. So, the next aspect to work on would be the eyes and the feathers. But already we can see some character around the beak. I quite like it. There's a curious aspect to his countenance. I might need to do a little bit more work here. That edge there looks a little bit odd, so I need to soften that in. But that's the kind of delicate tweaking that comes as you go along. You can't get all of the fine tweaking done as you proceed. It really is a matter of roughing things out, seeing how they work, seeing what the balance is. And I really am making it up as I go along with this. I have no idea. I mean, you saw from the outset, I did a very loose sketch. So I did that deliberately so that you would see me struggle to make sense of the lines and make something beautiful, interesting at least, relying just on my ability to use the tools well. And I think that's another thing I would say is something that I hold to be important. I'm less concerned with the subject matter or the story behind an imagery or whatever. I'm more concerned with how it's rendered, the way chisels are used, the way the ground is marked, the way the patterns and shadows are used to create an emotional content to the work. That's the bit that matters to me anyway. And that's really all I can show you is my way. Right. Eyes next.